So this morning, our focus quote is from the text, chapter 13. See no one then as guilty, and you will affirm the truth of guiltlessness unto yourself. This comes out of the section or the reading in the text titled "The Cloud of Guiltless" or "The Cloud of Guilt." And this morning, I'm going to share my recent experience and lesson from Holy Spirit as it's related to this reading. You can find it in the text in chapter 13, section 9, on page 260, if you'd like to follow along with some of the readings. So this lesson for me from the Holy Spirit all started with a phone call late one night as Deb and I were sleeping. When we answered the phone in our bed, on the other end was our daughter, who was very upset. She was crying and unloading about the awful things that the father of her son and the father of our grandchild was doing, and he had just added another guilty item to the list. So we let her unload and got her settled down a little bit and helped her to kind of gather herself up and get ready for work the next day. And we decided that we would continue the conversation the next day with her, which we did. And when we got together with her, one of the things she said in the conversation was, "Why does this keep happening to me?" For parents who care and love our children and want to see the best for them, it was hard to watch over the last 5 years the repetitive cycle of behavior that was hurtful and frustrating. And so Sarah had come to the place where she was ready to deal with this. She was ready to make a change in her life, and we felt good about that, and we wanted to be truly helpful to her. And so we started that process. She needed to file a motion for custody and placement and child support, things that she had not really paid attention to for a long time that caused her a lot of pain. And that first day that I spent with her in helping her with this process or beginning that process, I noticed that I was starting to get caught up in the drama as well. She would share a story with me about the way he was behaving, and I would chime in and go, "Yeah, that's right, he shouldn't be doing that." Okay, I'm pointing that. And this, for me, to add a little more context, I myself have gone through the process of going through a divorce and doing the custody paperwork and the placement and visitation and child support. And of course, I felt like I had the experience and the know-how on how to help her through the process and what is right and what is wrong with the whole situation. And coming from that background, that past, if you will, it helped me to slide into the drama with her and slide into pointing fingers and saying, "Yeah, you're right. You know, he shouldn't be doing this and he should be doing that." And I kind of became aware that I was doing this on that first day. And so I didn't get too deep, but I was deep enough that it was, you know, from what Jesus is sharing with us in A Course in Miracles, it was enough. And I started to realize that I didn't want to look at the father of my grandchild with as an enemy. And I wanted to look at him in a different way, but also be truly helpful at the same time. And I also didn't want to continue to feed into our daughter's drama and teach her the same thing. So the next morning, kind of having that awareness inside of myself, oh, I'm kind of starting to get caught up in this, and this is not really the place that I want to be in. I went to Spirit the next morning, and I said my little prayer that he had given me not too long ago. He leadeth me and knows the way which I know not, and yet he will never keep from me all that he would have me know, all that he would have me learn. And I can trust him to communicate to me all that he knows for me. So with that prayer, I opened up and I said, you know, what would be helpful to me here? How do you want me to see this? And I immediately got in my meditation to look at the cloud of guilt. And it was amazing to see how relevant it was to this situation as I began to read through it. So for example, here, looking at the first paragraph, in sentence two, Jesus shares, the guilty always condemn, and having done so, they will still condemn, linking the future to the past, as is the ego's law. Fidelity to this law lets no light in, for it demands fidelity to darkness and forbids awakening. And I'm like, wow, here we go. It's starting already. And he and Holy Spirit are helping me to see this is exactly what's happening right now. And as you know, if you know from my sharings in the past, the light is very important to me, and I want to continue to awaken to it within myself. And he's telling me that this is blocking it, whether I realize it or not. Let's take a look at another reminder in paragraph two, sentence two. He says, make no one fearful, for his guilt is yours, and by obeying the ego's harsh commandments, you bring its condemnation on yourself, and you will not escape the punishment it offers those who obey it. The ego rewards fidelity to it with pain, for faith in it is pain. And what came to mind was, as I was on that first day, as I was kind of getting caught up with the drama and the pointing fingers, there was moments where I had fantasies of the next time that I saw the father of our grandchild, that I was going to get in his face nose to nose, and I was going to tap on his chest and say, you're not doing this right, and you should be doing this, and you need to be a responsible father, okay? It says right here, make no one fearful, for his guilt is yours. So I had to, I'm like, wow, you know, how do I approach this situation and be truly helpful with the right mind without making him fearful, without making my daughter fearful, and in not doing that, not bring these harsh ego's harsh commandments back on myself, okay? Because we don't realize that when we're doing that stuff, we're sending energy out into the universe or out into the mind. And that unconscious guilt energy that we're sending out, because it's projected, it eventually comes back to us and manifests in our life and our experience. And it's building this cloud of guilt, unconscious guilt in our mind. It's blocking the light. So I had to become willing to say, well, He leadeth me and knows the way which I know not. So I had to be willing to let go of that little fantasy. And that's really all it was, because I really wasn't going to do that in the first place. But I did take a few moments to fantasize about it in my mind. In paragraph 3 says, the world can give you only what you gave it for being nothing but your own projection. It has no meaning apart from what you found in it and placed your faith in. So that ties in with this idea of it's going, you know, I'm going to project it and it's going to come back to me. And I don't want that to happen. He also says, be faithful unto darkness and you will not see, because your faith will be rewarded as you gave it. Now he's referring to the light here. I want to see the light when I go within. And when we're in the habit of pointing out the guilt in others, what they should be doing, what they shouldn't be doing, we're creating that darkness within our minds that's blocking the light. Because we're being faithful to that out of habit and the way we've been brought up and just the way we join in with the ego world. So we need to step back from that if we want to reach the light within our minds. And recognize through his sharings that this kind of thinking is creating that darkness. When we close our eyes and we go within, all we see is darkness most of the time until some visions come or the light comes. Now that is an example of when we're projecting guilt by blaming things on other, you know, seeing the guilt in others and pointing that out, okay? There's another form of guilt that we do, and I have an example of, is when I was returning from deployment with my soldier friends. We went out to dinner one night at Pizza Hut, and I was not feeling very well. I was just tired from all of this, very fatigued from all of the traveling. I was sick. And we went out for pizza one night, and one of the individuals asked to share if I was interested in sharing a pizza with him, and I declined because I was just not in a good mood. I later felt guilty about that. And when we got home and went through the welcome home process, meeting our families and friends that were there waiting for us, it was a real chaotic time. And I had an opportunity to say goodbye to everyone in our unit. There was only 7 of us. But I missed the one guy who, over my deployment, I really appreciated this individual and I grew to really like him. And I wanted to say hi to his wife and his kid and meet his kids, who I learned a lot about while we were away. But in the chaos, I forgot. And missed it altogether, went home. And so I started feeling guilty about that. I felt really bad about it. And I had ego thoughts that came up and said, you're an asshole. Okay. And I was tormented by that with a lot of pain. And as I was looking at this idea, this cloud of guilt with Jesus, he helped me to see something I didn't quite see before. Because initially, I felt guilty because I turned down the offer to share because I was in a bad mood, and I felt guilty because I missed. But he said there's another layer here. Was I'm saying that he's guilty too. I'm unconsciously projecting onto this other individual that he is guilty of thinking he doesn't like me. Okay? I'm the one that's really thinking that. I'm thinking that he doesn't like me, but I am unconsciously projecting that onto him in this situation. So there was another layer that I didn't even see until I looked at it with the Holy Spirit and with Jesus. And I'm like, oh, wow, that's interesting. It's a little deeper, a little more covert. And he says, you know, this is adding to the cloud of guilt. And they had two instances, you know, the pizza example and the welcome home example. And this guilt that I felt there, that was really bothering me. I was having trouble letting it go. And I even asked Holy Spirit about calling him and sharing this to help the healing process. And I got no every time. And I'm like, oh man. And I think he wanted, you know, first of all, it's an inside job. This individual probably hasn't even noticed any of this, or if he did, right. It's very minor and probably, you know, it's gone. But I gave it a lot of energy. And as I read here, let's take a look at paragraph 6. Again, Jesus says, see no one then as guilty. That includes myself, which was harder. And you will affirm the truth of guiltlessness unto yourself. And every condemnation that you offer the Son of God lies the conviction of your own guilt. If you would have the Holy Spirit make you free of it, accept his offer of atonement for all your brothers. Again, he's saying, accept the Holy Spirit's offer of atonement for your brothers. For me, the atonement is the light. He says in paragraph 7 at the beginning, guilt makes you blind. For while you see one spot of guilt within you, you will not see the light. And by projecting it, the world seems dark and shrouded in your guilt. You throw a dark veil over it and you see it because you cannot look within. At the end of that paragraph, he says, if you would look within, you would see only the atonement, shining in quiet and in peace upon the altar to your Father. So, I realized here as I was working with him on this that he was reminding me not to go out and try to fix it in the world. First of all, it is the right thing to ask Holy Spirit. There are times when he will say, yes, you should make the phone call and make amends. But this time, I think it was an inside job. It was a part of this lesson. And in this lesson several times, he's reminding me that to go within to the atonement, to the light. So, I decided to start doing that because the ego plan for me to heal this guilt was to call the guy and try to work through it that way. I'm avoiding going within. So eventually I got to the point where I decided, okay, I'm going to go within for this situation in my mind with this guy and practice reaching the light. With the father of my grandson, the same thing. I did the same thing. And what was interesting is with this soldier friend, when I did go within, and I practiced several times over several days, eventually I reached the light. And what was interesting is that when it flashed within my mind, it flashed with two stars. And the symbology to me of that was the pizza incident and the welcome home incident is forgiven. Okay. And what I've noticed after that was the intensity of the guilt or the fear was gone. You know, he talks about time is collapsed when the miracle happens. I really felt an inner shift after that happened. And that it was noticeable, especially that intensity. And I was like, wow, this is cool. It kind of works. I was reminded of that again. And the urge to want to call him and try to make amends and talk about it, that urge went away for the first time in several weeks. So that was an important reminder to me. The other person was Sarah's situation, father's situation, and I began to go within and practice the same thing, reaching the light, as he's reminded me here, and applying it to that situation. After a few days, I eventually reached it again, and again it flashed with two stars, two white stars. And I thought that was interesting that that happened twice in a row. And on that one, what I got was, I actually felt like I had forgiven Sarah and my grandson on some level. And some level I didn't even understand, but there was some maybe unconscious anger or guilt there that was in need of healing. But that's what I got, even though I was kind of working on it. I think I must have been doing okay, because I have consciously been choosing, when I think about the father of my grandson now, to think of it as he's innocent, he needs help. And I am being truly helpful to our daughter, and I'm being truly helpful to him with spirit to help him to learn how to be a little bit more responsible. But I'm doing it from a place, from the eyes of spirit. When I see him, I'm looking at him, and I met him. I've been very cordial and open in my heart to just be non-judgmental and open and just truly helpful. So I feel like I'm in the right space. There's no hidden anger or anything. And to allow the court process to assist our daughter and him as it was set up to be. But what was interesting is that the light came to help me forgive something else related to the relationship, and it came in twos again. So in paragraph 7 at the end, I think I already mentioned this, if you would look within, you would see only the atonement shining in quiet and peace upon the altar to your father. In paragraph 8, he says, do not be afraid to look within. The ego tells you all is black with guilt within you and bids you not to look. Instead, it bids you look upon your brothers and see the guilt in them. Yet this you cannot do without remaining blind. For those who see their brothers in the dark and guilty in the dark which they shroud them are too afraid to look upon the light within. He closes in paragraph 13, or at the end of this paragraph 8, the last sentence here. One last reminder. Look upon the light he placed within you and learn that what you feared was there has been replaced with love. So as we go into our meditation now, perhaps this sharing has reminded you of some cases or examples in your own life where you may be consciously or unconsciously joining with others in your mind and projecting guilt, and recognizing that you really don't want to be coming from this place, and to offer to the atonement now with the Holy Spirit to ask him to help you to reach beyond that cloud of guilt within your own mind and to find the light that's shining there in radiance, for all of us. So let's practice that now for a little while. If you would, close your eyes and begin to relax and sink down into that place where the Holy Spirit resides within you, and let him help you to take a look at whatever it may be coming up for you, and allow him to offer that to the light within you. When you're ready, let's slowly bring your attention back to the room. I received some new insights from Holy Spirit about one of those situations during our meditation. And he said that one of the reasons why he didn't want me to call him, because he wanted me to stop trying to get other people to reinforce my guilt thoughts. He suggested instead that I consider giving him a call just to ask how he's doing. He says comes down to, I care about him and other people, and just to express my caring in a different way, just to call him, hey, how are you doing? How's your family doing? And leave all the guilty stuff out of it, and that would be enough. And I thought, well, that's refreshing, new way of thinking. So I'm grateful to Holy Spirit for his insights and his help, and I trust that everyone else is getting their own guidance from our personal friend. So in closing, we thank him. And next week, Rev Deb will be speaking on judgment is a block to happiness. So we'll look forward to hearing Deb's insights. And as we close, we remind ourselves that the light in one awakens it in all. And may we all have a blessed week. Namaste.
Make your donation today by going to donate.miraclesone.org.